What's going on, guys? It's Bromley at Empire Barbell, and today we're going to talk about patellar tendonitis. Now, this is something that sidelined me in the past. I've had a few bouts that lasted a few months at a time, and then I've had one bad bout that's been going on about a year. So I'm going to talk about what it is, how it's affected me, and what I've done to get rid of it so I could go back to training again. So with tendonitis, we're talking about an inflammation of the tendon. We're talking about a tendonopathy. It's some type of dysfunction in the tendon. So you have the tendons, which are these fibrous bands that are rigid. They're like these steel cables that attach the muscle to the bone and facilitate the movement of the joint when the muscle contracts. So they have a certain amount of pliability, more so than bones do, but they are not as flexible or as mobile as, say, muscle tissue is. Muscle tissue is made to regenerate very quickly. It has a lot of blood flow, and it's one of the reasons that muscles heal so fast, you recover so fast. Tendons absolutely do not. And when you overstrain a tendon, either by doing too much work or handling too much load all at once, the tendon takes on damage. And part of the process of that damage getting fixed and repaired is this inflammation cycle. So when we end up with this cycle where inflammation and pain sets in, and then the amount of work that you would normally do to increase the integrity of the tendon and make it stronger, more resilient, actually is more likely to kick off and go right back into that cycle of inflammation and pain. And it becomes this cycle that's very hard to get out of. So with patellar tendonitis, we have the patella, you know, it's your kneecap, and patellar tendonitis is below. If you have pain above, that's not your patellar tendon, that's your quadricep tendon. So patellar tendon is going to be either right where it attaches on the kneecap or where it attaches right on the tibial tuberosity, right on the front. And if you push on that area, you should feel some pretty intense pain. So the ways you get patellar tendonitis, if you're a lifter, it's by doing too much work or handling too much weight, or maybe your knee tracking forward a little too much on one movement. But runners get it, jumpers get it, athletes get it. And when it sets in, it becomes very hard to maintain the amount of work you need to build proficiency in your field, whatever that might be. So the first thing you have to do, if you received it as a byproduct of your regular training, you have to modulate the amount of work you're doing. So we adjust the volume and load. So for a weightlifter like me, I have to adjust the amount of work I'm doing. In the past, I've gotten it from frequent squatting. And in order to allow the amount of recovery my body is able to do to kind of overtake the amount of tear down the training does, I had to drop the frequency back, drop the amount of work back. Now, we don't do nothing. At no point do we stop training, because if you stop training, you're not going to get blood flow in. You're not going to strengthen the tendon. You're just going to allow the area to kind of atrophy. You're going to be less stable, and you're probably going to be more prone to some issue down the road. So we just dial it back. If there's a certain weight threshold that causes the pain to set in, then you stay below that weight threshold. If there's a certain frequency or number of reps or amount of work that causes that pain and inflammation to set in again, you stay well below that. If you're a runner, if you're a track athlete, you might have to adjust the exercises, the movements you do. If there's certain sprints, certain drills you do that cause the pain to set in, do your best to stay away from those or replace them with things that get a similar training effect without causing so much pain and inflammation. For squatting specifically, box squats were very effective, and something like leg presses with your feet up higher, those both tend to take strain off the knees. So if you're doing a squat where you keep your knees back, where you loaded your hips more, that tends to be a lot better. Things like lunges, things like hack squats, things like front squats where the knee tracks forward quite a bit, those tend to put a lot more stress on the knee joint, and it tends to be a little harder to recover in the context of doing those types of things. So adjust the volume and load, adjust the exercise. Once we do that, then we need to start managing the pain and inflammation, because it's the cycle that we're trying to break. So the first way we look to managing pain and inflammation is usually ice. Now, ice has been a little controversial over the last few years. There have been some studies that suggest it doesn't quite work the same way that we thought it did. All I know is that in the trenches with elite athletes, RICE, rice is always recommended. Rest, ice, compression, elevation. Ice by itself works as an analgesic. We know that. It numbs the area. It helps pain subside. That by itself makes it valuable. We also know that ice causes the blood vessels to shunt. They close, which drives blood away from the area. The idea is that that helps reduce inflammation. Now, even if there are some issues with the way it works, the mechanism by which we think it does that, by driving blood away, what happens is you allow for blood to flow back in. There's some things it does with your lymphatic system. So as the area heats up, those blood vessels dilate again, blood flows back in. The idea is that this helps with the process of shuttling away waste product and shuttling back in nutrients so that the repair cycle is accelerated. Now with tendons specifically, that whole repair cycle is difficult because tendons don't get a lot of blood flow. I actually had a full break. I don't know if you can see this scar. I had a full break on my ankle where the tibia and fibula, where it sits, the very bottom part of the tibia and fibula broke all the way across. So my foot was dangling like a slinky. Now, the reason it took 3 months to heal and not 6 weeks was because where the tibia and fibula connect, there's this webbing of connective tissue that connects it. And it basically keeps the bones from sliding down the side of your foot. It's called the syndesmosis. And that syndesmotic connective tissue is what I had to wait on. I had to wait for that to grow back so that I could use my leg again. And that took more time than the actual bones healing. So bones actually have a good amount of blood flow. Tendons don't. That's why tendons take so much longer to heal. Bad sprains are actually more devastating and longer to recover from than full bone breaks. So when you look at, we actually have a bunch of arm wrestlers that are equally invested in trying to get their tendons as thick and durable as possible. And when they do a really hard practice, they get this severe inflammation in their arm, through their elbow, and up through their shoulder. And after a really, really hard training workout, a lot of them will go and do a bunch of banded arm work. The idea is that you're going to get those tissues sliding, those surfaces sliding across each other. Blood's going to get delivered to the tendons, and it's going to heal, recover, get thicker a lot faster. So that's why they do that work. It'd be easy to look at that work and think, well, you're just piling on. You're just doing, you know, more tear down, more work that's going to delay the recovery process. And actually work that is oriented towards blood flow getting to the area is going to help quite a bit. So that's where this whole pain and inflammation cycle comes in, because if the area is inflamed and you're not getting a lot of active blood flow to the area, it's very hard to break that cycle. It's very hard to grow at a faster rate than the teardown. So the other pain and inflammation fix that people use by default are anti-inflammatories, things like ibuprofen. Now they work very well and they're reliable, but you do not want them to be a crutch. If you take too much ibuprofen, either too high a dose or too frequently, it can have some negative effects. One of which is eating away at the lining of your stomach. Reliance on ibuprofen can lead to things like ulcers. So you don't want to use NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, as a crutch. They are to be used sparingly when you do need it. So if I do a very hard lower body workout, if my knees are tender the next day, I will absolutely use some ibuprofen. If I know I'm slated for a workout that's likely to kick up that inflammation, I might take a little bit before, but the goal is to kind of wean myself off it and not need it on a daily basis. Now, when you can reliably and consistently keep the pain and inflammation down by adjusting the load, choosing better exercises, and intelligently using things like ice and anti-inflammatories, then we need to start focusing on our actual rehab work. Now, these are the things that are actually going to cause structural changes. These are the things that will cause adaptation so that you are more durable, more resilient, and you are much less likely to get inflammation issues down the road. So we start with blood flow. I just talked about blood flow, getting blood in. So that involves things that are going to help drive blood in and then at some point take blood out. Contrast therapy is very good. That's going ice and alternating heat, ice, heat. So we cause that blood flowing in, blood flowing out. Every time you heat the area gets saturated with blood as the blood vessels dilate. Every time you ice it, the blood vessels shunt, drives blood away. So that can help with kind of resetting a cycle of inflammation. I'm a big fan of contrast therapy. Other methods, when you're about to go into, let's say, a hard training session, wearing sleeves, using heating pads beforehand, things that get the area hot, that helps get blood flow in, and it might actually make you feel better in the moment, but we're also looking at it from a long-term rehabilitative standpoint. Don't be afraid of icy hot. Icy hot works well. Before I squat, I'll actually hop on a recumbent bike or do a few minutes worth of sled drags. 10 minutes on a cycle or 5 or 6 minutes of backward sled drags, I find gets just enough blood in right around my knee, in those muscles that surround my knee, that I feel just immensely better. I feel so much better. I can get through the workout with less pain. I feel like I'm doing less damage, and I feel like I'm going to recover a lot faster. And again, just as a basic training principle, doing that type of blood flow work is going to help recovery. So you can do things like banded movements, things like, again, sled drags, recumbent cycling. You can do those multiple times a day. You can do them on a daily basis because it's not going to cause so much stress that it kicks up the inflammation. It should just be oriented on getting blood in and helping with that recovery process. Then we have to go into things that cause the tendon to actually strengthen. So this is where we're looking at the amount of load the tendon's having to take on. I have seen things like negatives, so eccentric work, and isometric work being prescribed as a way of getting the tendon used to that tension, hopefully causing it to grow and get stronger, but not taxing it to the point where you are keeping that cycle of inflammation going. It seems to be that things that put the joint through a very full range of motion, those tend to be the things that are harder to recover from. So a really easy isometric would be something like a wall sit, where you're leaning back against a wall, feet in front of you, and you find a degree of bend in your knees where you can feel the tension. You feel like the knees are having to maintain rigidness. You feel the tendons taking on that tension, but it's not overwhelmingly painful. And then you go for time. Now, for many of you strong guys, if you've been lifting for a while, you might find that a traditional wall sit isn't really taxing enough. You're not really going to get a lot of adaptive stress out of that. So then you can move to something like a single leg wall sit, where you're just bending one knee at a time. Now this joint has to take on a little more stress to deal with your entire body weight. Now the last thing I saw that I came across that has actually worked wonders over the last couple of weeks, I did this with my bicep tendonitis up in my shoulder that was giving me problems, but I wasn't as diligent because it was a spot that was a little harder to get to. The patellar tendon is a lot easier to get to, and that makes it this a much more consistent, viable form of therapy because you don't have to dig around so much. But this is cross fiber massage. So if we look at the way the fibers run on the patellar tendon, if you apply a friction, a type of rubbing, massaging force that is perpendicular to the fibers, there is an idea, there's a concept that you are, let's say, breaking up tissue that didn't lay down quite right, or that might be more prone to being torn or damaged on a very small scale, that might perpetuate that type of inflammation. That's what I heard from the physical therapist. Sounds a little bro science-y to me. I don't know if that's actually what's going on, but I do know that the friction, the rubbing side to side by just kind of grabbing on, taking my three fingers right here, just digging into that tender spot and then moving side to side, or even taking one finger and rubbing side to side, right where it's painful. I noticed after about 4 minutes on each patella, or about 4 minutes on each part of the patellar tendon, I noticed that the pain actually subsided. It was a little less tender. And then I noticed after a couple sessions in a single day, the next day my knees felt noticeably better. And this is something you can do when you're watching TV, when you're sitting at your office desk. Just try to clock off about 3 or 4 minutes at a time. Don't be shy, get into where it hurts. You're not gonna cause more damage. And the idea is that this causes enough disruption to the system. I can see it contributing to blood flow. I can see it contributing to the way that the collagen fiber synthesizes in your tendon. Whatever it does, it causes enough disruption that it seems to be a very productive way of promoting new growth in the tendon. I don't know what the mechanism is, but I do know that if I put it into practice and it works and it does so for other people, it's worth keeping in your toolbox. So I like that. You don't need to get super aggressive or use a massage gun or like kneel on a lacrosse ball. Literally just a couple of fingers, just hooked right into the tender spot, just rub side to side. It's worked wonders. So in a nutshell, this is your game plan for kicking patellar tendonitis. Being smart about your training, better load selection and exercise selection, managing the pain and inflammation with ice, ibuprofen and anti-inflammatories, using heat in an intelligent way, and then going into consistent rehab work, focusing on getting blood to the area, strengthening the tendon, and doing our cross-fiber massage protocol. This all contributes to keeping the inflammation down, reducing pain, and strengthening the tendon in a way that you're going to repair faster than you tear down. And that's going to be key to kicking you out of the cycle. So that's what I got for today. This has all helped me get back to my old squat numbers. I've actually been able, every time I get into the mid fours, that's where my knees get dodgy. I've actually been able to get back up into the mid fives for my working sets across. My knees have been a lot kinder to me. And I feel like this is a sustainable trend where I can hit the numbers I'm projected to hit without causing debilitating pain. And for the first time in months, I actually feel like I'm on a mend right now. And it's a big testament to what this type of protocol has been able to do for me. So go ahead and leave your questions in the comments, or go ahead and start a thread on the forum, empire-forum.com. Once again, this is Bronley from Empire Barbell. Thanks for watching. I'll see you.